Tell me, Eric, are we on TV?
No, we are on the internet. So. But we are.
Well,
oh yeah,
sure,
we are
then.
On
better
TV.
Quit. Better quit.
Yeah, but we are on TV.
Yeah, we are on TV. Talking Void TV. How cool is that? You know, and we have the podcast as well, The Precipice of Dreams. So we are all set to have another. Wonderful evening with all of you in chat and with my special guest Eric for tonight, who's on this show for the third time, I think, right?
Yeah, it's my third time.
It's your third time.
I'm sorry, you guys, it's my third time.
It's his first third time.
You have to bear with me.
and someone is watching us on TV. Imagine that. Well, and hello, everybody. I see Donker Rups, I see Esner, and I have seen Mireneos, so they've all asked us some questions, and there is our Dungeon Master. So a couple of known people in chat, and Deadly Toilet Paper, I already did a shout-out, but he got to us when we were playing Planescape Torment yesterday on Parallel Projection, so it's quite nice that he's here. Hope you enjoyed this show as well. It's very talkative. Anyway, I'm hosting this show. I'm your host, Jasper. It's Sesso on the top of the screen as well. And we're going to have a lot of fun. Our topic will be, when did you break alignment and regretted doing it? That will not be the only part of the show, because we will also be discussing The Precipice of Dreams, our main campaign. And I'm going to ask Eric some personal questions, like what kind of underwear does he like and everything. But
Batman
before
underwear.
We go... What?
Batman underwear, yeah.
Batman underwear, of course.
I'm not wearing it right now. I'm wearing my Star Wars underwear, so...
So, your lightsaber is safe then. Anyway... before we go into the introduction, because I did this the other way around last time and felt different, let's do some socials. You are currently watching us on Twitch TV. You can follow us and you can subscribe to us, which will help us out greatly, make us make produce more content and everything. We are very proud that we've reached this status on this part of our journey. And we hope you like to subscribe to us and... Yeah, you get this thing in front of your name, which is pretty cool. All our videos will get to YouTube, and you can subscribe there as well and do all kinds of stuff. We haven't reached any kind of affiliate status there yet, but we will in the hopefully near future. We have our Instagram, where you can see what we are doing behind the screens. We have our Discord, which is getting filled up with content, but not that many people yet. So feel welcome to join us there. And then we, of course, have our Facebook page, where you can find some information about us as well. We have been doing this for about half a year, a little less, no less.
A little more.
Well, with our pre-games and setup testing and everything, we've been at it for half a year. And we are currently doing three shows, Talking Void, where we discuss the previous week's adventure of Precipice of Dreams and have a main topic. And then we have the Parallel Projections evening, which you saw, Deadly Toilet Paper, which is such a funny name to say out loud. Anyway, before we go into to everything else, Eric, do you want to add something to this or not?
No, let's just get started. I'm really excited.
So then we are going to show you our super dark introduction, which has nothing to do with the show, but is absolutely, absolutely awesome. Did I get back too early or not? I don't know. I just pushed the button. That was it. Well, I think that we started with a little chaos, less than normal, at least. I hope chat agrees with me. And I'm sorry for that. Normally the chaos is, there's a bit more chaos. But I hoped I cut the introduction early so that there at least was some chaos at the start of this program. Erik, do you still follow me, or am I losing you at this point?
I'm just waiting till I have something to say. Just go ahead, Jesper. Talk your void and...
Talk your void. Let chaos reign, yes.
Let chaos reign,
Do the kiss emote if you agree. That's our own kiss emote. That's my familiar in The Precipice of Dreams, and I'm so proud that it got to be the first emote. And, of course, I came, it's mine. But it is Erik who designed the damned thing. It's not a damned thing. Anyway, when did you break alignment and regretted doing it? That's the main topic of the show. First thoughts, Erik?
First thoughts? So you want to know when I broke alignment?
No, first thoughts.
First thoughts. My first thoughts are... Damn, this question. I hope more people would react, but everybody is so content with their alignment.
Yeah, that's true. So I have to say that before we start the whole show, we have started the show already, but anyway, this was kind of a misser because we have exactly two answers to this question, and all the other people were like, "What?"
That's break alignment.
But, what? But I have some great conversation around these two things that people talked about, and about alignment in general, and we can talk about that later on. But before we start that, we are of course are going to some highlights, and that's talking about art with you just a bit, because in recent episodes, and we haven't talked for four episodes to be exact, or three. Mm-hmm. I know we switched one around at some point, so yeah. Anyway, you have added a lot of art to our main show. Our layout for the show has changed. We have seen all kinds of new creatures. So tell us about that.
Yeah, Roger, the Dungeon Master, he asked me if I would partake in preparing art for coming sessions. And yeah, Roger was wary about doing that because he would give away... He would give away a lot of information to me what would happen during the next show. Because if he said, I want a scary dragon with venom dripping up from his mouth, and I want him to hold two characters in his hands, and I want you to draw it. I would know what would happen next show, but I'm okay with it. I like it. I like, I like looking forward to these encounters and these things that we will encounter during the show. So I was okay with it. So I just started drawing, and every day I get new requests for Roger, or every couple of days I get new requests from Roger. So it's been fun doing it.
So are you a precog right now? No, precognitive powers. For your Thomas?
No. I don't act on the things that I draw. So I want you to draw a couple of plant creatures. So I still act like I don't know that there are going to be plant creatures in the
even
next encounter.
Even though a tentacle was wrapped around your leg?
Yeah, because the first thing I thought was that I got caught up with my with the gang members that we encountered in the city.
Yeah.
And that they caught me with a rope or something like that. And then Roger asked me, you must draw a plant creature and it has long tentacles. And I thought, I know where this is going.
Yeah. I think it's great that you can have such a... an understanding with your dungeon master and do this art for him and still not act on the knowledge you have been given. And I don't feel that you are exploiting it in any way. I know you are not exploiting it anyway, but that's a great thing to do.
Yeah. Although I'm still pushing the Death of Bowen moment, so. But every time Roger denies my request, so.
Yeah.
We'll have to push that one. Yeah.
Okay. Well, hopefully the Death of Bowen will. I will get resurrected as a Wyvern. Because we know you're drawing that kind of art. Show us the sketches, Esner says. Are there sketches?
I do. Yeah, that's one of the stupid things I do. I finish an art piece step by step. And because I work in Photoshop, Photoshop is a very heavy program on your computer. So it takes up a lot of working space. And I flatten layers. Most of the times. So I do a couple of layers on top of each other, draw a couple of effects on them, and when I'm content with it, I just flatten a couple of layers and then work a couple of layers above that and then flatten those. And that's my work in progress. I do have a couple of sketches that I send to Roger. So I always app him like, is this the thing you're looking for? And then he will comment on that and then we'll work further on that. So maybe I will post those sketches later.
Yeah, would be cool. Yeah. So Donker Rup says something very interesting. Jasper's alignment is chaos, just chaos. Do you agree with that, Erik?
100%.
100%. And I always feel like I'm such a relaxed, normal, balanced person and everything.
Yeah. Well, now with your character Bowen, you're chaotic. So every time you start talking, you never know what's coming out of your mouth. And I did have to especially with last session when you woke up naked next to a dead boar. We can say that because people should just watch our show.
Yeah.
When you woke up naked next to a dead boar, I wasn't surprised.
I wasn't surprised. Is that because of Jasper or is that because of Bowen then?
That's because of how you play Bowen. I wasn't surprised and that scared me. So, yeah, you are very chaotic. But as a dungeon master, once you DM, you are very organized. At least that's what I have in mind. You always know what you want from the players. You always know how to react to your players when we screw everything up, as usual.
Yeah.
So, and I always feel like we are playing in a world that has been pre-written, but it's all organized in your head somewhere.
Yeah.
Well, that's where you're organized, but with Bowen, no, you're one total chaotic mess.
Oh, that's so funny that you say that, because, well, my alignment might not reflect that.
But I've never encountered you as a player, because I met you only as a DM, so I never experienced you as a player.
Yeah, that's true. First time playing together. Yeah. So, great bridge towards our last episode of Restless. Mm-hmm. What do you think of the episode?
I loved it. It was a very, very awesome episode.
I think I know why. That's because you were very impressed with the nakedness of Bowen.
I still try to get that mental image out of my head, but...
Yeah, well, the image is a great one, I think, in more than one sense.
let's just skip that whole topic. No, but I really love the episode. Not many people know this, but Roger was feeling very sick that day. He had a heavy cold that evening. But he felt a little under the weather, and still he managed to pull off a great show that felt, excited, I felt all these things that we normally feel during the show, and I always have in mind that every time he does a show, he does it a little bit better than the last time, and yeah, that was exactly that with the last show. So I'm looking forward to the next show.
Yeah, great. How did you experience it? Well, I thought this was great. And I thought it was very well balanced between the characters. We talked about this after the show, I think, but it's true. It's true. Because we all had our little time in the spotlight. I obviously, when the spot was on me, I reflected the light back because of my lack of clothing. I liked my interaction with you. I liked my interaction with the boar. I liked what happened at the lodge with Solwing and Altleaf. I liked what happened to Gunther Letz. But all these things really clicked together, and then we even went out on an adventure and totally screwed that up. So and started doing some combat. I liked it. I liked it very much, and thought there were some great moments of tension and stuff, especially from you towards me. Bowen didn't actually registrate that tension, but
That was the first. That was the longest encounter that we had together in this show. You normally you tend to go towards either Solwing or Altleaf as Bowen, and now you were forced to do a bit with Thomas that didn't involve threatening each other or berating each other, but just trying to see if we could get out of the situation that we were in, you were in. I really liked that moment.
So what did you think of the situation?
Yeah, I have 101 thoughts about it, but I am a DM myself, so I always have in the back of my head, oh my god, what did Roger do now?
At this great moment last time, let's see if I can... So a friend of mine who was in chat as well, but he said just before the show to me, he said, I like it so much that you, as much as myself, don't know what is going to happen. And then this session started with me obviously having some clue as to what was happening. Mm-hmm. And so he said, well, that didn't hold for long when the episode had ended. And... that's so funny because, it will get, we get back to this in the questions at the end of the show. But it's, I still don't know what's happening because there are some things I want to do with my character. But as you said, I have no idea what Roger is planning with it. So I know some of my, I know what has happened to me, but that doesn't mean I know how the world fits around my character. Strange predicament. And I'm not talking about that thing again. It's just a predicament. So that was cool.
Okay.
Yeah, and well, I liked that it was Thomas who came.
I saw Kiss flying away, and every time we split up, weird stuff happens. So the first thing that got in Thomas's mind is, oh my god, not again. So he just went straight after Kiss and tried to see if he could pick him up, because I didn't know the situation with Bowen yet at that point. So yeah, it was a logical thing to do, and I loved the moment that I loved the way that we interacted with each other, because Thomas is thinking tactically, okay, so if this guy is going to attack me, how am I going to get out of the situation, and how am I going to save the owl? And when you said, oh yeah, you can turn me invisible, I just, all the alarm bells in my head were just going off.
So much fun. So and then we have of course had the Solwing Altleaf interactions.
What did you think of that one?
Yeah,
those were great too. Also Solwing and Altleaf were two characters that interacted very little with each other during previous sessions, and now they were also forced to engage with each other. And yeah, I love those moments where different kinds of characters engage with each other small settings so they can develop their characters and their relations between those characters. As a DM, I do this. I also do this with my players. If I know that some of my players haven't spoken in character to each other a lot, I always try to pick a situation where I can pluck out these two characters and put them in the situation where they are dependent upon each other and they need to work together so they can these characters can learn to know each other. And I don't know if Rigé did that, but I think every character, all our characters are learning to know each other during the last, during all previous sessions.
Yeah.
There's a lot of dynamic between all characters, and it's not just those two characters are their own clique, and those two characters are their own clique.
Well, I like where our relationship is going between Thomas and Bowen, because... Mm-hmm. Well, I was quite angry at you for a while.
I know.
Can you imagine?
Like, you well.
and then Alterief happened, and her adventure in the other world. That gave me some... And while that was happening, we went to the warehouse and you did some great stuff. So some bonds have been restored. Mm-hmm. But that's why I liked it so much when you turned up outside of the town, and this was purely because I let Kiss stay with you. Because the whole thing with Kiss and you is, well, when we are in combat, Kiss is with you because I know you're going to get hurt, and probably be one of the first ones to get hurt. But also, when we split up the party, I can look out of Kiss's eyes. So it's very logical to put him where I am not. Yeah, and worked out great this time. Yeah. And then there was the stealthy sneaking up on the bandits, which was proving to be very successful. and the start of a huge combat, I think. I still don't know if we can survive this.
If I look, and that's the thing, we are both DMs. So if we look at the numbers, we are against the odds, fighting against the odds right now. If you purely look at what a dungeon master what the dungeon master pitted against us, we are very high against the numbers. So I am very curious how next show will go.
Yeah, but
it makes it more exciting.
What's funny is that about every conversation I have with Roger about balancing combat and everything is that high numbers work against you so badly in the fifth edition, and it's what he keeps doing with us.
I really love it, because every time we get a very cool situation with plenty of role playing opportunities and at the same time a lot of awesome combat, and it's a nice mix. So,
and I think combat is starting to grow as well, because we are getting more options to put out there. We can survive a few hits right now,
let's just see where Roger takes us next time.
You should
all watch too.
You hear him? You hear him, internet? You should all watch as well. So, that was great talking about the previous episode. That was great talking about your art. Let's go into the main topic.
Yeah, okay, let's go.
Let's do the tune. Anyway. I don't have a tune for that. Maybe we should have a tune for that. I don't know. So the topic is, when did you break alignment and regretted doing it? We have a couple of answers to this question. Literally a couple, two. And the first one is this. And I think this is a fun one for you, Erik, because you might... deduce something about this, and maybe it's fun for Michel as well. Maybe it's fun for a lot of people, I don't know. Anyway, during an encounter with a plant-like creatures that attacked a vineyard, The animal companion of our ranger died. When we came to the culprit, we wanted to question him, but his staff enchanted our paladin and cleric, and so I, a neutral good sorcerer, killed him on the spot.
Ha! And that's from the Curse of Strahd.
Yeah, so spoilers there, which is okay, I think.
just a small spoiler, but I know the encounter. I pitted my players against it too, so.
So Curse of Strahd is we have a great relationship, I think, with Dutch 20, which is quite a large Discord. Look at that, quite a large Discord server with a lot of Dutch Dungeons and Dragons players, and they tend to play through Curse of Strahd quite a lot. I know there are a couple of games being played that are purely Curse of Strahd. So they are pretty they don't want to spoil the adventure for any others. I got this answer, I knew what it was for, and I tried to cloak it a bit by and saying culprit instead of something. Yeah, and then you screw it up. Anyway, then you screw it up again. Yeah. But let's go.
I'm
to,
sorry. Yeah.
No, you should screw it up again. Whatever. Right? No, not whatever, but I like Dutch 20. I'm on their at sometimes in their lobbies and just talking to them, and I'm part of it right now, so not to them, to us. And well, I'm a member, I'm not one. Well, you understand what I mean. Anyway, let's go to what is being said in this comment. So what is being said is that the fact is that he killed a creature. In cold blood, in a way. Yeah. But the conversation immediately arose because I had this this question came from a conversation I had on the Discord server there. That is this breaking alignment, or is just this just what you do when one of your or two of your comrades get enchanted by the guy who killed? Who was responsible for killing the animal companion of the ranger in your party? What do you think? Did he break alignment here? For him, it was breaking alignment. So there's no question about that. He felt bad about it, and he thought, well, I shouldn't have done that. So that's basically his remark about this topic. But what do you think?
Well, the first thing is you can always opt to do non-lethal damage to an enemy character. So if you say, I want to neutralize a character, but I don't want to kill him, I can always say, I'll do him damage and I drop him to zero hit points and then I don't kill him. That's an option. So if you are truly neutral good or lawful good and you want this character to be judged by just judiciary system, you could opt for that. But in the heat of the moment, I do understand the player.
And is it something evil that he did? Is it something neutral that he did? What is it?
As a dungeon master, I wouldn't hold it against my players if they did something like that to a character that has caused them so much trouble and caused the death of pets. It's a difficult question. It's a very difficult question. What do you think?
I kind of agree with you, but that's the interesting thing that we came to talk about. That. Neutral good, although it gives you some guidelines as to what you are when you are neutral good, it isn't set in stone per se. And it is because we could both, as Erik and Jasper, be lawful good people and still have totally different worldviews when we look at the situations around us. So for him, it was something that was contradictory to his contradictionary. That's a funny word. Contradictory to his alignment, and which made him feel bad about his decision. If they were lawful good, it would be a bit different, says the deadly toilet paper. Yeah, so is that the case? Because, you know, if the paladin and the cleric both get enchanted, and I think it was something in the kind of hypnotic pattern or something like that, or such a spell that totally gets you out of combat and you can't act anymore, if the druid then would go on to do something harmful, like, well, cast a druid spell of some sort, then you are then you have had a setback already before you can act. So is the acting before the druid will act again, is that the thing that that shifts balance towards doing a neutral good or a lawful good thing? Are you really going to wait for him when you're a lawful good to take the first action after his staff, because it wasn't really the oh, I said the culprit. I should have said the culprit, but it's the druid. Anyway, so it's acting after he, because the staff apparently did something passive to these these characters, and then if he had done it actively, that would have been an offensive action, and then it would be okay to do it anyway, or.
So you mean when if the sorcerer acted in the heat of the moment, would that have been better than after the fact, when they all had the chance to cool down?
Yeah, but I think that he now acted in the heat of the moment because there was some threat towards them, right?
Yeah. I always say to my players,
the Book of Opposition. No, sorry, it's an answer to the chat.
I always say to my players, I have a very loose alignment system in my game. So players are not lawful good and chaotic evil, etc. They are good, or they have tendencies towards evil, and they should roleplay their characters as such. And but if they are in combat and they're trying to fend for their lives, if they kill an enemy creature, I wouldn't hold that against my players. That's just what you do to survive. And I don't know. It's a difficult question in this case, because you can always opt to do non-lethal damage if you think that's what your character is supposed to do. So,
but he killed him, so that's the thing.
So if in your eyes it was the wrong thing to do, then it's the wrong thing to do.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, if you in feel a sense, like because... I can go to the garden, find a cat, kill it, for example, and I think that's the right thing to do, but it doesn't make me a good person.
Okay.
This got dark
very quickly.
Well, that's because you're saying such a thing that if you turn it around, it can become quite dark.
If you take that example... If you take that example, we always have spiders in the house. Everybody has spiders in the house. I always try to capture the spider with a glass and a piece of paper and then put it outside.
Yeah.
But as soon as I encounter a fly, I kill it.
Yeah, okay.
Does that make me evil or good?
No, but
why did I handle the situation? I think it's a situation that... And my wife always kills a spider, and I always hold it against her, like, but you're killing a spider, or a spider
kills... By the way, I love cats, so I would never hurt a cat.
Yeah.
Shit. Where's our cat? I don't know where he is. But, in the garden, probably. He's in the garden, bro.
No, but it's a difficult question. If you feel bad about it... Good, feel bad about it. That means you care about your character, and you really feel the consequences about what your character did. And next time, this is a learning moment, next time you won't do it that way, and you will try to find another solution.
Yeah.
or you will go down the path of evil.
So let's talk about that one, because now I have a very long story to tell you. And well, previous episode of Talking Void, Donker Rups was in chat and he said, well, I now suddenly feel different about a thing that I've done in the past. I said, then you better enter that thing you're talking about for the next Talking Void. And so he did. So here it comes. It's a long one, so be prepared. Donker Rup says, during one of Jasper's campaigns, when I was merely a fresh D&D player with a handful of sessions of playtime experience, the group and I had made a plan to kidnap a potential powerful foe in order to clear the air in a peaceful manner. Let's call him the Master. Of course, the plan backfired. Hard. The situation went south very, very quickly, and my character and I feared for our lives. My character, normally played as a chaotic neutral personality, thought of a way out to leave the group for my own safety. While leaving, I wanted to make sure I used some of my magical abilities to make sure more of my companions had the chance to get out, if they too wanted to flee. It was at that very moment that one of the children of the Master came to the balcony to see what all the ruckus was about. Without hesitation, I changed my plan completely. It all made sense in my head. The child has to go down. Make the Master attend to his child so my group and I could escape, alive and well. And so, I cast Firebolt, targeting the child. Sorry. It wasn't until the last Talking Void I realized it was a very, very villainous plan. The group and I don't just mean the characters, so he also meant the players, did not take it very well. The outcome was also something my character regrets deeply, costing him several parts of his body and an agonizing experience, scarring him for life. My character does not know, he low-rolled his firebolt and the child didn't die. So, this was a great balcony scene. you know how my campaigns can get. They can get a bit dark sometimes. But the table was stunned when that firebolt went off and targeted the child. Now I had given that escalated quick. Yeah, I had given the child 2 hit points, and the firebolt does 1d10 damage, and he rolled a 3, which was not over half his hit points. Below 0, otherwise he would have instantly died. Instead, his nightgown went up in flames and the child fell burning to the ground and stayed there. So, what do we think about this one?
Don't know, I don't want to comment on it.
Everything you will say now will be balanced after you die and go to heaven or hell. Or
I'm going to hell, so
okay, so that's easy then. Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's clearly evil. I don't know. Was he playing a lawful good character or
chaotic neutral? Chaotic neutral. So there's something to be said for that, but.
With chaotic neutral, you always try.
It take care of yourself. That's the take care of yourself.
Yeah. So he played according to his. No, it's more tendency towards evil. I do think chaotic neutral doesn't mean you can do evil and good all the time and get away with it. Chaotic neutral is just try to see if you can get out of a situation better than you entered the situation. But it doesn't mean you have to viciously slaughter everything in your path to be better than that, because that's chaotic evil.
Yeah.
No, yeah, that definitely breaks alignment at that point.
Yeah, so Esner says in chat, is alignment about intentions or about outcomes? My question immediately is, does it matter in this case? Because the outcome was, disturbing, as were the intentions in a way, using the child as a means to plan your escape.
Alignment is about intentions, not outcomes, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah.
though the outcome can help you cope with the result afterwards somewhat. But
because if you do something good and it backfires, that doesn't mean and it doesn't work, that doesn't mean you did something bad.
Yeah. Well, is that that's a difficult one as well, because then you have to the thing where you try to save both people are who are being held by the villain, and because you did that, they were both killed. So you might not you could also have walked away and do the task that the villain had given you to, or pay him or whatever. You know, it's always a in hostage situations that gets complicated. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Well, there are exceptions to every rule, I think. And if in that case, in a hostage situation, you make the wrong decision, but the outcome or the you do it with good intent and the outcome is good as well, then you're a hero. But if you fail at that, are you responsible for their deaths or not? Because we all know that in a hostage situation, you shouldn't do that and everything. So there are shades of gray in there. I suppose the question is, did he cast a fireball with the knowledge it would most certainly kill the child, or it was just mean to be a distraction? Albeit sounds silly because it was a fireball. It was firebolt, so it was the cantrip. Well, I think he did it, as he said, he did it with the intention to distract the daddy. He didn't want to try to kill the child. That's true. But now imagine that this guy is trying to escape your house and pulls a gun on your child and shoots it so that you're going to cure it and let him escape.
I have no idea. Yeah, you can always do a threatening fireball, just went right past the child, and the room behind the child just went up in flames, and that would have been distracting, not trying to set the kid on fire as a distraction. Yeah. That's just pure evil. No, I'm sorry. I can't see it any other way than that.
Afterwards, the guards came to the house, and there was a bit of a standoff between the owners, the father of the children, and the mother of the children, and the party and the guards. And just before these guards entered the house, the mother had dragged the character away to the cellar and behind a secret, to a secret part of their home, and there he stayed to be tortured for a couple of days, which also adds to the strangeness of the situation, of course, because the father might not have been a very clean guy himself.
Yeah.
As was the mother, but yeah, well, you can't blame the child for that, right?
Nope. Also, at the end, that uses children in his campaign is also very dark always, because every time every time you introduce a child in a situation, you always try to try to get a reaction out of your players. What do you do with this moral dilemma? I also did it, because during the Curse of Strahd campaign, I can say this because this is one of the things I wrote myself inside the campaign. During the Curse of Strahd campaign, one of my players went missing, and he woke up in a room full of coffins. And he got there because two vampires kidnapped him, and they placed him inside the room to feed on later. There were three coffins inside the room. Two were open and empty, and one was still closed. He couldn't get out of the room because the room was locked, so he needed to find a way to get out of the room, to find a key or something. And then the coffin went open, and a child vampire walked out. "I am so hungry. Can you help me, mister?" What do you do in this situation? Because you have a vampire that wants to feed, but it's a kid.
Yeah.
And the situation went this way, that the player really tried his best not to hurt the vampire that was trying to eat him. and try to get out of the room. But it was a very nasty situation, because you place a child in that situation, and what do you do? Do you kill? I'm sorry, people. This is getting really dark, this show, but do you kill the child, or do you attack the child, or neutralize the child, knowing full well that you are attacking a child? Or do you try to reason with it and try to set it aside and get yourself out of danger without attacking it? Yeah. So that was very nasty. And I learned one thing during all these years that I DM myself. I shouldn't put children in situations. Hostage rescue situations where they have a child tagging along. All my players really want to kill the child after three sessions because they have this feeling because the child is right behind them. Can you help me? I'm so scared. And they really don't like children in their campaign. So I stopped using children in the campaigns altogether.
Yeah. Well, my situation was that there was the Lord and Lady of the house were just hosting a party. And the players took that as an opportunity at their house. So, and the players were taking that as an opportunity to make a big distraction by setting their garden on fire and trying to kidnap the Lord of the Manor, not realizing how powerful he was. And because of this, the children woke up upstairs because they simply had children. But I hadn't expected this to happen as well. So he's very silent in chat right now, by the way.
Fireball.
Deadly Toilet Paper says, I might commit what would be seen as an evil act in order to escape with my life as an act of selfishness, as opposed to as an inherent means of wanting to commit evil.
Hmm.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
And Mirenea says, what about you breaking alignment and did not regret it? Or who can you no longer trust to look after your child in real life based on game actions? Well, that last sentence, Mirenea, we will not go there because it's fantasy and we don't want to have another satanic panic at our hands here. I take care of my children pretty well, as do you. And as the... well, Eric doesn't have any children yet. But, let's not go there. I love my children, and they are growing up to be good children.
Yeah.
I hope. But there's something to be said for not regretting it, of course, because there are those situations. I should have asked this question in a broader sense. When did you deny your moral compass or something? You know, instead of making it pure alignment. But Well, have we said enough about this?
Deadly Toilet Paper is in the game, in the chat at the moment. Did you ever break alignment and regretted it? We can look back on that later if he reacts to this.
Learned my lesson, haha. It took a while. but that's the other thing, you know. It was a very dramatic that session, and they went to jail, and the guards were corrupt, and they were going to be hanged, and they escaped that, and there was quite a backlash because they cannot return to that city anymore. And the strange thing is, they can't return to any city they enter because they always mess it up. But so there was a big backlash towards the situation, and. You have to see that the party is almost divided in an equal amount of good characters, and of which at least two are lawful good, and some more shady characters. there's a lot of discussion across the table between those two groups, and which is fun, which is interesting.
It is. I don't really play, to be honest. I just like this philosophical dilemma of the situation.
This is the guy who finished Planescape Torment a week ago and watched our stream yesterday. And it's very nice of you to join once again.
Awesome.
Or girl. It's I still don't know, because Deadly Toilet Paper is, for me, is quite sexless. So... then we finished that question, I think. And then we, this was the general thing that has been said about me asking this question online. We don't use alignment, was one. We don't break alignment, was the other. We shift our alignment over time, was another one. So those are the main things that came out of that question. And
I do like the alignment shifts, though. One of the best, because every character evolves during during all sessions. We had Roderick, the dwarf character that was with us for 8 years, and Roderick really changed during the course of the adventure, I think, more than most of us.
Yeah, the funny thing is that the act that made him lose his paladinhood did not exactly come from a non-lawful good place, but by the laws he had to abide to in a way. And that made him question if he was a good person himself, and that made him go down a dark path towards the end when he stopped playing after a time. He was on the uptake again, going towards his hey, thanks Marty for the subscription, thank you so much.
Thank you,
first live subscription, that's so cool. Awesome. Welcome to the chat. Yo bros. you just missed an important thing, except if you were here for a longer time. Thank you. Cool.
Awesome.
And welcome to chat, and welcome to join us. So, where were we? Yeah, so he was on the uptake again, but Deadly Toilet Paper says... can you shift alignments in a game? And I think the simple answer is yes, you can.
Yeah, we're
because
in a game like Dungeons and Dragons or Pathfinder, you can always shift alignments, and you really need to discuss it with the dungeon master, I think, or your game master, because if you shift alignments like a paladin, it will have effects on the game. If you shift alignments with, let's say, a sorcerer or a warlock with demonic pacts, and you go good, that will have effect on your spell casting and your abilities. So you can shift alignments, but it won't always be for the better of your character. So
I think it will more suit your character in the end, because in the same campaign where Donkere Rups did the thing he did, another character was confronted with the death of his father in front of his eyes, which might have been, there's a lot of correlation and causality involved, but it wasn't a welcome experience for him, let's put it that way, and that made him quite angry and made him decide things that he wouldn't have done before, and that shifted his alignment towards neutrality instead of the good character that he was before. The alignment shifted because of his behavior. Is that always the case? I don't really know. Can you shift your alignment and start adjusting your behavior? That would be a bit strange, right?
Yeah, but your alignment shifts also shifts because of your environment, the way the world affects you. Look at Anakin Skywalker turned to Darth Vader, or what are other good examples? Well, a lot of movie villains don't always start as good as evil characters.
Yeah.
So you always have an alignment shift somewhere along the road.
Yeah. Yeah, was the seed always there? That's the question then, or how your nature nurture thing.
And I do think that during exploring your character and shifting alignments during your adventures that is a very interesting thing to do. If you're always the good character doing always the same thing, you get predictable. And when you shift alignments during with logical reasons, you can explore more sides to your character, I think.
Yeah, I think so as well. So shifting is great. Not playing with alignment. Well, let's first do the we do not break alignment. So in that case, you always, your character will always have the same alignment and you will always act according to that alignment. What do you think of that one?
That's also a good way to play. Although I do like it when my players do something they're not supposed to do and they get... Yeah, I don't punish my players anymore. So I'm looking from a perspective as a DM right now. I don't punish my players anymore. I just look at the way of how are we going to work this into your character. One of my previous campaigns that one of the players made a pact with a demon to get more power from that. And I really started playing with the whole what's her relationship with the demon and how does this affect her character, how does this affect her powers. So it was a really, really interesting way to play because she started out as a as a neutral good character and she shifted towards evil. We didn't play it out all the way because the campaign bled to death after a couple of years, which was a shame. But yeah, it was really awesome to see that shift from the goody-goody character to a character that took more and more risks and tried to improve herself by any means necessary along the way.
Yeah, but that's another example of shifting then, right?
So not breaking a character,
it's easy for some things, because, if you're playing Wolfguard, you're always kind of, what are you? Neutral good? Well, we don't have an alignment, right?
No, but I'm always neutral good with Wolfguard. So he will punch someone in the face if he doesn't like him, but he wouldn't kill someone in cold blood just because he has a bad day.
Yeah, and he's a better rager, so...
Though doors are always unsafe around him.
Yeah, but doors are evil, so that's always a good act. Could you potentially start off as evil, but to everyone else you are actually good in order to deceive the good aligned characters from malicious or evil intent? Yes, I think that's the best way to play evil in the Dungeons & Dragons campaign, because the other thing might be becoming a murder hobo, which is never fun. If you identify evil as doing as killing people or always getting the most money out of every situation, then it will very quickly not be fun anymore to be in a party with good characters. But when you hide your evil intent and make use of the party around you to get to your goals without them even noticing, that's great evil play, I think.
Yeah. Look at our current campaign. You don't know much about Thomas at the moment. And the things
he does. Are we getting spoilers here, Eric?
No. But the things he does when the party is around are always shifting towards good, nightly. But as soon as he is on his own, the instance with Bowen when he threatened Bowen's life.
They didn't even. Palpatine is a great example. They didn't even believe me when I said that you would could have said that during
and that's sleepy good time, my friend. Yeah. No, Thomas is always good when others are around. But is he inherently evil? Is he inherently good? Nobody knows at this point. He could be good, he could be evil.
Yeah.
You just have to find out.
Yeah, we have.
But also with Bowen, I mean, what in the hell's happened with Bowen?
What do you mean?
I don't, because Bowen is always very pious and, oh, Aedon is my lord and master, yeah. And you always should follow the 10 tenets of Aedon, and then
there are
he
eight, but okay.
It, yeah, the 12 tenets of Aedon.
Yeah.
And then he wakes up naked, lying next to a boar that has cuts all over him. Is that because Bowen didn't know that he did that, or does he know that he does it and keeps it a secret to the party? And does that make him good, evil, or anything in between?
I'm as good as they come, Thomas.
Yeah, I know you as a DM, so you could be inherently evil.
Can you be a good person and DM as an evil one? That's the, well, this is getting so meta. I don't know. Mm. Yeah, probably. So, with that in mind, let's go to our first question. Because these are answers. Now we're going to have some questions, which... Well, it doesn't quite end this subject because I think the first question is a great transition question when it comes to this. It's by Donker Rups. Well, imagine that. You mentioned that some players do not use alignment. For me, alignment is a great explanation. Let me put a space between those letters. Here we go. Great explanation for the values my character holds dear. How could alignment be something negative that players would want to get rid of? I don't understand. And then there's... what's happening? Alignment. So, there we go. You've seen it live on this show.
Mm-hmm.
Why would you not use alignment? Because the third option was not using alignment at all. We did that when we started playing our long-lasting campaign that's been on for 9 years. I also did it with the other campaign that started a year later and has been going on for 8 years. But I didn't
do
it.
Is your other campaign also going on for 8 years now?
Yeah, I just started that a year later.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So, my most recent campaign that I'm still DMing is where Donker Rups is part of. And... Mm. We got there in a whole different way. I came to a game night and introduced them to Dungeons and Dragons, and then I kind of got stuck with them, which is great because it's such an amazing party. And they got stuck with me in a way as well. I started with alignment because I was explaining 5th edition Dungeons and Dragons, and it it kind of brought me back to bringing back alignment, really, to my campaigns, and suddenly felt as a great tool for me as a dungeon master as well to predict their actions or tell them how morality would work when you are a lawful good or a neutral character and everything. And and when I think of the other parties, I can most of the time stick an alignment to them, you know.
I think
it's just strange, of course, because you are a battle rager and you're somewhere in between. You have this kind of chaotic nature, but you have this lawful aspect, so neutral good wouldn't be a surprise to me, but I would never call you neutral or neutral evil, even. You're really on the side of good.
Yeah, but I'm not a lawful good, so.
No, but.
If I don't like someone, I'll punch him in the face. I won't wait for a judge.
Yeah,
I'm looking at you, Eric Goldman.
Eric Goldman, yeah. So that's the other thing. Yeah. That retarded paper says, I suppose neutral characters are in a way people who don't sway to either alignment heavily in either direction, so they could use alignment still but not rely on it so much.
Yeah. I had a campaign years ago, and I also started with alignment, but we quickly released alignment because the guys in my party at that moment were We're used to games like God of War and violent games, and they just wanted to go into a world and go into a tavern, ask questions. If the innkeeper didn't give them the answers, they would beat up the innkeeper to get some answers. So the whole alignment system in that game didn't work, and I quickly let go of it. So that's one of the situations where I would say alignment just doesn't work in this campaign. It's just a bunch of murder hobos that just want to kick ass and get loot and get their get rewards, and they don't rely heavily on role-playing. I do think that if you rely heavily on role-playing, you should employ something. You should employ alignment.
Do you employ alignment, or do you employ a moral compass?
Way? Moral compass. That's maybe a better word.
Yeah, because I think I agree to some degree. I agree because it really helps. And if you then go all over the spectrum in some way, can at least tell a character from, well, is this what you would do, or aren't you going a bit off the charts right now, or even, are you feeling okay, dear player, because the last session you were sticking your knife into everybody's belly, while the 20 sessions before that you were a lawful good character, so how are you? You know? Something happening in real life
I do. I do think there are those types of players that always want to get away with everything, and you have players that always tend towards. I'm playing a true neutral character. As soon as I hear those words, I always know. Yeah, this player just wants to kick ass whenever he wants to, and he just wants to steal when it befits him, and uphold the law when in other situations. And so the true neutral is one that I try to steer away from as much as possible.
Well, the true neutral, I think there's a difference between neutral and true neutral. At least when I from the Planescape stuff, that's there was a difference, because true neutral always balances out everything, and neutral goes with the wind in a way. So to answer the deadly toilet paper question that now has appeared, what would be the practical alignment? So you do what you think is best only when assessing the situation, each as it comes to you. Chaotic neutral, well, I don't think that's chaotic neutral, because that's always egoistical. And if you assess every situation, then it might not always be an egoistical choice that you have to make to solve the situation. So I think that's a more the true terrain of neutrality. But as always, it's what you're saying is also true. If you it's the intent of the player that makes the neutral alignment all about being able to do everything instead of thinking about everything.
Because as soon as you get the character sheets from the players and they fill in their alignment, you can always see, okay, this might be the intention of the player. If someone has a lawful good on it and another player has lawful evil on it, you always know these players are going to clash in the side of party. There are going to be conflicts and morality questions. But I have experienced it with a couple of parties now, and every time a player says I'm neutral or chaotic neutral, they always tend to go to the, yes, I'm going to kill someone now, and I'll loot his corpse, and next time I'm going to the innkeeper, and I'm going to slap him in his face because I want to, because I'm true neutral. They always use it as an excuse to do the total bizarre things you wouldn't do in real life, just because they can, and that's one of the things I try to steer away from as a DM as much as possible. I always try to.
It's not fun. It's not even fun for the others.
No, because I had a player once, and that the rest of the party. It was a 5-man party, and the rest of the party really wanted to role play. So they went into the tavern and they asked the innkeeper, "Do you know something about the person that is missing?" And I said, yeah, the innkeeper, you have the feeling that he does, he holds back his information. So the players were discussing among each other, okay, how can we do this? Should we pay off the innkeeper, or should we put him aside and ask him what's wrong? And one of the players, and he did this every time there was a situation that the other players wanted to role play, he just went to the innkeeper and I'll slap him in his face, and I'm rolling in the, and I'm rolling for what's it called, intimidation. And he just rolled a dice, and I say, okay, this, but why do you do that? Yeah, because my character is true neutral, and that's what my character would have done. And every time I think back to that moment, and it's always messes up the game for the rest of the players, I think.
So going back to the chat, because
No,
it's a good answer, and I think I'm leaving it. I'm coming back to it in a moment, but I'm skipping a lot of things in chat, especially Mireneas, who is saying they are more like guidelines anyway, Captain. Mireneas also says revealing alignments to other players is an open invitation to metagaming, in my opinion. I disagree with that one, of course, because if a player can draw the enemies that he will encounter in the next session, like Eric does, you can also disconnect from any open displays of alignment. And that rhetoric paper says again, I hear very rarely people play true neutral because it's too hard to play, and I agree with that. True neutral is an unrealistic alignment.
Yeah, the real true neutral is very hard to play.
Yeah, and I think it's the only thing where it truly is applicable is in the Outruns, the plane around surrounding the spire that holds Sigil on top, and which is at the center of the other 16 outer planes. That's the true neutral plane by default, and there you can never the person who helps you might smite you the next day. That's the basic idea of that. And of course, as a dungeon master, you can do that because you don't have to resolve every other issue that that person would have had in his life or will do in the future. But to do it as a player is, I think, near impossible and unrealistic in a way. Yeah. But why I don't, I said why I don't agree with that. And your example is a perfect example of why neutrality in that way is a misinterpretation from a player and a way to get his way anytime he wants.
I always, as soon as I get a character sheet and I see true neutral or chaotic neutral, I always approach my player before we start the campaign and ask him, what do you want out of your character and why do you choose true neutral? And then I'll try to see if another alignment might fit it the character better. Because I don't mind players that want to play evil characters, but they don't. I always say to my players, don't expect the world to revolve around your character. As soon as your character does something evil, like slap the bartender, this will have repercussions in the world. So you might get picked up by the guards. And if your party members are lawful good, they will abide by the law and you will get thrown in jail by yourself.
Yeah. Well, let's go to the next question, because otherwise we'll be here at 12 o'clock. Mireneas says, he's in chat as well, we have a couple of serious talking void lovers who always give us some answers. Sometimes I even ask them. At first I had some problems with this because I thought, can I do that? But yes, I can. which is might be a chaotic neutral thing. I don't know. Anyway, I've seen Critical Role, the talk show there, and that always these people are always the same people as well, and they have a community of like a million, so whatever. Now I've rectified that. What's the question Mireneas is asking? What are your wildest theories story-wise?
Sorry, what are your wildest what?
Theories story-wise.
With the current campaign?
Yeah.
My wildest theories? Well, I think At the moment, I think Bowen is one of the characters I should really watch out for, because I truly do not know what's going on with that guy. I do think he has some kind of affliction, like lycanthropy or something darker that correlates with the story. So the corruption that spreads across the land. So that's one theory. I think he has a shape-shifting kind of disease that he isn't truly aware of, and we should really watch out for that, because he will pose a problem for the party. Another theory I have is, well, not a theory, but we always speculate about each other's characters, what the other one is playing, because we didn't tell each other which classes we are playing, which races we are playing. And I do have a good I do have an idea what Michel is playing at the moment with Oddleaf. So I do know which race she is right now, and I know her classes, but I keep that to myself because that's for you guys to find out also. So
I know exactly what he's playing.
And I know what he's playing because I played the same type of character myself. So.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. As soon as the whole angel wings thing came up, I thought, oh, okay, I see what's going on. Yeah.
Well, those are individual things. My wildest theory is right now that everything we are doing will probably be towards a goal that's exactly the opposite goal of what we are trying to achieve. That's because I know Roger a bit. I fear that that at some point we're going to think, man, what did we do? Why? But I have no idea what that other thing might be, or how that will come to pass or anything. But there's always this dread feeling in the back of my head that I've said it before about Adon, the god that I worship. I so hope he's just a good god, because I want to worship in honest belief and everything. I'm not suspicious at all, says Donker Rup. So there you go. Erik.
I think Adon is Cthulhu in disguise.
I so in disguise even. Yeah, I so hope he is not, though. And I also, of course, I have this idea as well, but that's not what I'm hoping as either Jasper or Bowen.
Yeah. My theory is that Adon, that the corruption in the world is a direct effect of the coming of Adon, and maybe even opposing Adon, because Adon is, I think Adon is an evil god, and the corruption is a way of the gods, or a way of the land to fight against Adon.
Well, knowing Roger, he might twist the story that wounds are actually what is needed on the world you are on currently. That is what Mireneus is saying, so that overlaps greatly with your comment.
Yeah, because I really like the Studio Ghibli films, you know, those ones, Princess Mononoke, and it's always mankind versus nature, and there is also always a lot of corruption in the land and creatures corrupting. So I do think we are going that way with the campaign, but we will find out.
Maybe not, and that's what keeps it exciting.
Yeah,
and that's the part that we do not know. So hopefully that was enough of an answer for you. Question 3 by Esner N, also in chat, of course. In the last episode, it has become abundantly clear that there is a connection between our unlikely adventurers. What would you speculate binds you together? The secondary part of this question is also, Bowen cooked some dinners with rotten dice. What is up with his culinary confidence? Two in one. For the first part, are we connected?
I think it's just a chance encounter, being at the wrong place at the wrong time.
Yeah.
I don't think we're connected. Yeah, obviously, Gunther and Thomas are connected. But yeah. I don't think the characters are connected like they were meant to meet each other and they were meant, they have a destiny together. I do think they all have their own destiny and it just happens to be the, yeah, that they met each other at this point in time.
Yeah. So as I said, as I've already written the preface of my of our upcoming own gaming system, Voidwalkers, I wrote there, in this game you can be an accountant, but if you play an accountant, you will be the accountant that gets into the most weird situations ever, because otherwise you wouldn't be specifically that accountant, because otherwise your whole experience of a campaign would be boring, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the case here, you know, because of course it might have been chance that brought us together, but of course we haven't chosen the boring people to play, and we all have our baggage in a way, and so that will be becoming clearer in the future, or is becoming clear right now. So yeah, there's a chance, and of course there's an aspect of the story itself. Mm-hmm. Following up on Eric's last answer, it might be that we are seeing what we are seeing is that all characters are receiving abilities from their gods, which would not bode well for Bowen.
Yeah. Like Gunther,
oh man.
Like Gunther, he has the ability to cough himself to death, so.
Yeah, Miren, they said it was, he needed to feed more, last meals were a bore. So to go into the second part of that question, rotten rolls for my culinary escapades. Yeah, it was so funny. Rolling a one twice for my cooking skills on exactly those moments where I was in sheer panic as Bowen. Sometimes the dice just confirm how you are feeling. That was so funny as well about the natural 20 that I rolled for the survival check. Or it was 19, I don't even know, but I got a result of 21 or 22 on that one. Through sheer luck, Bowen stumbled into the right way of cleaning those tracks. Sometimes it just fits the story. Well, it was hyperactive on coffee. So sometimes those roles just suddenly fit the story so well. It's all chance, but go with the flow. It's the same with Audrey's role of a one when she was telling the story in the lodge. Yeah. And she's awesome. A great storyteller. And the way Michel did it was by, he said this on the last episode, he isn't the best storyteller, so it was just the wrong story at the wrong time, you know? And that was what that one implied on his role. And it's just so funny when those things happen and just fit the story so well. Mm-hmm. And my cooking, rolling two ones on the, what is it? Maybe 8 rolls I did for cooking checks in the whole adventure now. It's just a great result for those specific moments. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that a answer satisfactory, Mr. Esner N? I hope so, because I'm going to the next one. we're now towards the end of it all. Mireneus asks again, will Thomas start his own knightly order between brackets? I think he means Thieves Guild.
Oh, he might.
He might.
The thing is, Thomas is currently under the protection and the protection and in service to Sir Gunther. As soon as Sir Gunther isn't around, Thomas tends to slip back in his old habits. So, yeah, how his character evolves and what's in store for him, that's, he has a very uncertain future. That's all I will say.
Yeah,
he might join a knighthood, or he might be knighted, or he might turn up a villain. And yeah, it's purely that's the thing I said about the character evolving during during the course of an adventure. He is very susceptible. How do you say it? He's very influenced by his surroundings.
Susceptible,
yeah.
Well, not native English talkers here, but
no.
I think we're doing a great enough job of it. So I hope that is enough answer, because the next two questions are for you as well. What does Thomas think of Gunther? And it may seem that Gunther wants to leave this world. What's going on?
Yeah, I'm not going to divulge if Gunther is dying right now. It will take the fun away out of watching the show. So you just have to watch the show with that. Gunther is stable at the moment, so.
But what does Thomas think of Gunther?
What does he holds him in high esteem. He thinks Gunther is the one that's... He's like one of those troubled kids you see in shows where kids went down the wrong path and they go to some camp and they are starting to know each other, and they're starting to know to learn how to do teamwork. That's a bit the situation that Thomas is in right now. He has a dark past. I already showed you guys that multiple times. He has a dark past, and he's trying to get away from that. And Gunther is his lifeline out of that dark past. So he holds him in high esteem, and he hopes that that Gunther can give him the redemption he needs in this life.
Yeah. That's a great answer, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing I can say about it. But I'm also evolving Thomas and Gunther along the show, because other guys, like Michel, when he wrote up his character, he made an essay of 12 pages about who is Oddleaf, and I think Jasper did something around 5 or 6 pages about his character, or
something like that.
Yeah. I wrote 4 lines per character with my characters, because I don't want to I want to see where my characters go during the adventure, and don't want to be writing them up beforehand and deciding how they will be during the rest of the show. I want to explore these characters. So I always write up, if I do backstories for my characters, I always write up a small part of a backstory. And what is it? Are his tendencies? So is he good or is he evil? And
we have discussed this with Michel as well. I've discussed this on Talking Void with Michel as well, and I talked a bit about it with Roger as well, I think, on Talking Void. I can't even remember. We're on the 10th episode. Anyway, and that's that. I've written a long background, but and there are quite a lot of hooks, but as soon as we started playing, things have been changing every session, so... even then, I am not the same person that I would have tried to play if I had held strictly to my... Well, I have held strictly to my background, because I haven't changed anything. But the way I interpret it now is all because of how we are playing our characters. So retroactive backstories. Well, is that what you're doing? I don't think that's what you're doing.
No, adding to it, right? I'm not lying, but... As I recall it, Thomas had about the half of an A4 size paper backstory, and Gunther has one paragraph or 1.5 paragraph backstory. And Thomas has enough in his backstory for Roger to work with a background, and still a lot of open ends that we can explore during the game.
Yeah. So, for example, Donkerrups, that party, you know, they were all first-time players, and the background varied from non-existential to I think Donkerrups with about 11 pages or something, with whole dialogues integrated into it. Maybe it's even more than 11 pages. And another character had his whole journey mapped out on maps that I provided, and all kind of images. And so it were quite a different kind. There were all kinds of different backstories there as well. But the funny thing is that for Donkerrups, I could really go into detail about even the persons that they were going to meet, while the shorter descriptions gave me some handles, but a lot of freedom to add them to them as well. So both have their way to handle them as a dungeon master. And I like them both, short and long backstories. But I really enjoy reading the longer ones because they most often are fantastic.
As a DM, I always prefer shorter backstories because I always had players that have a tendency to do long backstories with, I am the hero of that and that village and my parents got murdered and this is my quest and this is what I'm doing and this is what I want to do. And that puts you on the spot as a DM because if you go completely the different direction, why would the player follow your adventure? Why would the player follow the party? Because his or her quest is very different from your intentions in the campaign. But like I had a player, one of my players, my brother, had a backstory, and he said his character, his family, his character's family were a cult of evil wizards. And in an X amount of time, they would destroy the world with the fire god. Well, I didn't have a fire god planned in my campaign, and I wasn't planning on doing that in my campaign. So I was really wrapping my head around, like, how am I going to work this in my campaign? Because we are going to run Curse of Strahd. And this is nowhere in Curse of Strahd, so...
But what you can do then is that's misguided knowledge about his parents' background, you know?
Sometimes you can really work with player backstories because they are very interesting and they have awesome hooks that a DM can work with. And other times players have such a wild backstory that doesn't fit into the world nor in the group that they are adventuring with. So, yeah, I always prefer a bit of shorter backstories.
It's so funny that you're saying that because I run free campaigns, as you all know by now. The one that you are in, when I created that, I had this thing about a piece of railroading and then an open world story, which wasn't, which revolved somewhat towards your backgrounds, but not a whole lot because it was open-ended and it wasn't really, you know right now that there was a lot, it was about you, but in a way it wasn't about you as well. So it could have been anyone, but it was specifically about you in this case. And then the other adventure that has been running for a very long time didn't focus on the backstories of the characters that much as well. But they were there, but it was really more like a streamlined campaign that totally got derailed, by the way. But with kind of epic storyline that changed so many times that I have lost count. And then the ones that I do on a monthly basis with those players, I really just took their backgrounds and tried to build a story around all these backgrounds with a main storyline crossing across all of them. Yeah. And they are experiencing that in a way. So instead of making adventure is really about all of them and not about the main... the thing that I might have wanted to do, I don't know. And there's a big villain, maybe. Can't spoil too much, of course. But there are all these things going on, and they are experiencing that. But I try, because I only play that campaign every month, only once a month, I mean. I really have to try to give each character something to work with, at least every two sessions, because otherwise it feels bad for me, at least. I don't know how their experience is. I could ask them, of course, but and that's why all these things overlap. There are the same characters that that they know from their backgrounds. And sometimes they have been given to me by the characters, but other times I say, you know, that priest you talked about, it's this guy, and then the other character, but that one was in my background, and keep silent about it. And that's how I am doing that campaign. So it's also how you want to do your campaign as well.
Yeah, I don't have a lot of time on my hands normally, so I do a lot of pre-written campaigns, so The Curse of Strahd and Lost of Mine of Phandelver. I'm doing a couple of one-shots from Tales of the Yawning Portal, so I rely more on those pre-written adventures and, yeah, give them my own sauce, so I convert them to my own idea, but... yeah, if my players have an epic backstory that tries to tries to get the focus of the DM, like, but this is what we are supposed to be doing for one character. As my DM style, it doesn't fit with my campaigns, and that's a shame because.
Oh no, it isn't a shame. It's the way you DM. It's not a shame. If I had even more time, I have very little time, but I try to use it as practically as I can to keep free campaigns up and do these shows. Man, sometimes I wonder where I get the time. But that's very intensive, and sometimes I'm pretty tired from doing it. So that's not the right way either. And I'm sometimes think about doing a pre-written campaign again, because I started out with a large one. I did the second edition Night Below, and I played that for 8 years or something. And I added a lot of my own things on it, because otherwise it would have been a pretty boring adventure. And you know, the Night Below is the same campaign that Matthew Caulfield does. Mm-hmm. For some reason, he can do it in half a year, and it took me 8 years to play through it with my party, and we played every Friday from 8 to 4 o'clock at night.
Holy shit.
Yeah. So there's quite a lot of different ways in DMing your campaigns as well, and
then again,
how involved your players are.
Yeah, but your DM style is way different than Matt Mercer.
Matthew Caulfield.
Matthew Caulfield, sorry. Yeah. Your DM style is way, way different, because with our campaign, we were standing in a room discussing how we would approach a villain, and that went on for 3 sessions. So
five sessions, 15 hours of talking.
So if you think Talking Void takes long, you should join one of our sessions.
So I missed
2 of the 5 sessions, and when I came back, it was still, oh my god, are we still talking about the villain?
Yeah, but there was a lot of lore dump as well in between, so that made it a bit more complicated. Yeah. Anyway, I think that's about all we have for the show tonight, except for the fact that we are going to this last thing, and we have our... we all say, is this the end? Yes, it is, but then we are going to talk a bit more, and we are telling you what the new topic is. Way easier than this topic, and it is, what is your favorite type of character to play, rules-wise?
Okay, so character class or...
class or race, those kinds of things.
So what's your favorite type of character build?
Oh man, are we getting it confused already? Well, it's rules-wise, so it's... Yeah?
Yeah, character build.
Maybe before we make the Instagram thingy, we'll discuss this one. Yeah, but your build. Your favorite character build. That's actually what it's about and why. Because I want to know why.
I don't have a favorite character.
Because I'm a philosopher, in a way. So that's the new topic. And
who will be the guest for your new, of the new show?
That will be Jin.
Jin? Oh, interesting. Jin,
yes. Mr. Solving himself will be joining me next time. I hope he realizes this. I did not ask him yet, but in the consecutive weeks that we do this.
Wow,
in order, he's in the next in order, in line, whatever.
And Jin has played a lot of interesting characters. I think the last time I saw him play anything in an else in the campaign, he was a parrot.
Parrot?
Yeah. When our two campaigns joined together, Jin was a parrot, right?
No, Detlef was a parrot.
Oh, Detlef
you're
was
confusing him now.
Okay. Yeah. Well, still, Jin has always always has a lot of interesting characters.
Well, he was that was a funny story as well, because that guy really wasn't a parrot, but because he had really had no body left, they polymorphed what was left of his body into a parrot, and it still had psionic ability, so that was pretty cool. What happens to your character if you can't attend a session just they are away somewhere? Yeah, that's an interesting question, that rhetorical paper, and that's a whole subject, a different subject matter, because some people... I'm not going into it too much, but the main things are the character can be played by another character that's at the table. He can just participate in combat, but make no real decisions. He could be away for a session or anything in between. It's what the party prefers. And one of my parties prefers that they are not played by anybody else. And then we have to come up with some kind of shenanigans. And other parties just say, oh, you have a guest player at the table and you play him for this session. That works great as well. Yeah.
So that's another good topic for another day.
Yeah, that's a very good topic. I should have put that one on. Should I? Should I? No, it's for the next time. We'll do this one, and then. But I'll keep that in mind. I like that one. And Okay. So that was the whole talking void thingy. Did you enjoy it, Chad? Did you have a great time? Did you learn something new? Or did you get totally blown away by our... Well, whatever.
Well...
Bing! You get the thumbs up. There we go. I like thumbs up. I learned so much. Thank you, Michelle. I enjoyed myself very much again, but I always have to ask my guest, did you enjoy yourself?
Yes. It's a 2.6 out of 5 stars. Definitely.
2.6 out of 5 stars. There we go. Yes. It's an F plus or whatever.
It's a very neutral rating.
I enjoyed myself. Next time you balance it with a 2.4 and then we get to that. That's more.
I did enjoy myself. Absolutely. Yeah.
I enjoy myself as well.
Time always flies when you do these kinds of things.
Yeah, and we are late again, so... but it doesn't matter. Highest rated talk show on IMDb. Well, thank you. You'll put us on IMDb, and I will be forever grateful to you.
Thank you, Ellen DeGeneres.
Well, we could easily surpass her ratings. Oh man, yeah, funny. So please follow us, subscribe to us, do all the things that that can help us to really make a difference. And subscriptions is open. We saw Marty subscribe to us today, which is thank you very much. And join us on our YouTube. We have all our content is on YouTube, and we really love for you to see what we have done there as well. And if you start with The Precipice, start at episode 1, which is our 4th episode, but which will take you straight into the story. And then, When will we next play Torment? Torment will be in 2 weeks on the Monday again. So it's a bi-weekly show. And next Monday will be the Precipice of Dreams, where we will be playing with the five of us. And with Roger, Dungeon Master, I play Bowen, as you might well know by now. Erik plays Thomas and Gunther, two characters. Michel plays Aldrieve, and Jin plays Solving. And that's a live campaign. Monday, November 11th, says Michel, which is of course the one who does parallel projections, and I'm his guest there. So, thanks for watching.
Yeah, thank you all.
I think it's always a good indicator that when we are enjoying ourselves that the show might be up to our standards. Mm-hmm. But it's nice to see that chat enjoyed it as well. No, it's the other way around, people. Thanks for watching. And with that, where's the outro? We are going to the outro. See you soon-ish.
Bye.
Goodbye.
See you next Monday.
Yeah, see you next Monday.